The Black Pool by French painter Gustave Courbet. Ornate 200-year-old slippers that were worn by an Indian prince. The Coming Storm by Dutch artist Cornelius Krieghoff. These are all rare and beautiful objects of art and antiquity. They were also all stolen, victims of one of the most mysterious illegal activities in the world, art theft. In Hollywood films, professional art thieves are stylish and the heists they devise are high tech. But few of us know much about the reality of this shady business. How do thieves dupe sophisticated security systems to steal from art galleries and museums? And who's buying priceless original art that can never safely be shown again? With each piece that is taken from a public gallery, a little part of history disappears. Every year, about 10,000 works of art are reported stolen around the world. 100,000 art objects and antiquities have been stolen from museums in the last two decades alone. The recovery rate is 20%, but the wait for their return may be as long as 30 years. And then, recovered objects are often badly damaged and require extensive restoration. Museums and galleries' primary objective must be to protect the art and antiquities to keep them safe and sound. Even still, FBI reports estimate that the market in stolen art and artifacts is massive, ranking only behind drug and gun trafficking.
I think you can speak to anyone in law enforcement, and there's, especially in the international community, but art theft is certainly recognized as a major crime, international major crime. The last figures I saw, I think, were from the FBI and Interpol that stated that the international trade of not just artwork, but artifacts, antiquities, was about $6 billion U.S. I mean, a thief is going to steal artwork for one reason and one reason only, and that's to make money. Whether they sell it at a ridiculous price, whether they already have a buyer, right? Because there are people throughout the world who are obsessed with their art collections. And maybe it's bragging rights to show off to their rich friends that they have this art piece. If you were to open up a museum or art gallery of all the stolen artwork, you would have an amazing institution with like 166 Rembrandts, 167 Renoirs, and the list goes on and on and on.
In the past, art galleries and museums did not have the kinds of high-tech security systems that are in use today.
Thinking 45 years ago or more, security then would have been very crude. Probably mostly door contacts on exterior doors, maybe door alarms that sounded an audible alarm, so if you were nearby, you could hear the alarm go off. So this would be, I would think, very archaic compared to today's standards.
Even still, art thieves needed to be clever and well-informed to pull off a heist. A high-profile robbery in Hamilton, Ontario, in 1960, was only possible because thieves knew enough about the existing security system to find weaknesses in it. Helen Haddon has been a volunteer at the Art Gallery of Hamilton for almost three decades. She vividly recalls events surrounding the robbery.
It was a bold theft, with a lot of clumsiness involved. But they were crafty enough to come in a rear door, which did not set off any kind of alarm because the minimal alarm system.
There may have been a door or doors that were not alarmed. A door contact could be easily circumvented not to cause an alarm, or a wire cut and they would not know it. So yes, it would have been easily done back then.
The Art Gallery of Hamilton is no longer situated in the building that was robbed. The original gallery was opened in 1913 in the space formerly used as the city's public library.
It was a very modest one-floor gallery composed of six rooms. But the thieves elected to break in through a lower panel of the rear emergency exit door, which therefore brought them right into the room called the Jewel Box Room, which contained the masterpieces of the gallery.
The stars of the collection were all conveniently located in this one wing of the gallery, so it was a natural target for the thieves. Dating mostly from the 19th century, the paintings that were stolen are invaluable pieces in art history created by important artists. These are their stories.
Well, Gustave Courbet, along with Manet, considered the two great heroes of French realism in the 19th century, which was an avant-garde movement. As Courbet said, I've never painted an angel because I don't see angels. So this total revolution in art, whereas before there was the Academy telling painters to paint historical subjects and mythological subjects in a very finished style, Courbet rebelled against that and painted ordinary life in a very broad manner and prided himself on his thick handling of the paint. So a revolutionary style and approach to subject matter. Le Puy Noir was from his native region, which is Ornans in eastern France near Germany. And he actually made very many versions of that particular subject, basically a gorge with a river flowing from it called Le Puy Noir. Probably a better translation would be Black Pool.
Well, The Coming Storm was painted by a Dutch-born artist called Cornelius Krieghoff. Well, it's small and quite meticulously painted, and it shows a foreboding-looking sky at the right and the rushing river at the lower right, and a canoe being hurriedly carried up a bank into the forest. So it's so typical Krieghoff, but he rendered atmosphere beautifully. He was a good, well-trained artist. Well, he painted exclusively in Quebec province, and he painted between Quebec and Montreal because he lived in both places. So a lot of his scenes are, he's rather like a Canadian Bruegel, you know, Bruegel painted in Europe, peasant scenes, and Cornelius Krieghoff could be considered our Canadian Bruegel.
This is an important piece that was handled brutally in the theft. Its return and restoration was a critical priority for the gallery.
So this is a wonderful portrait by Henri Fantin-Latour of Henri de Fitz-James, painted in 1867. Well, it's a wonderful work to have because really Fantin-Latour, his career divides itself interestingly into several different subject categories, floral and fruit still lifes, which he mainly did because they were so commercially popular amongst his English audience, and these imaginative fantasy subjects based on opera or mythology, but also portraiture. And it really is in portraiture where he excels. And so this is a portrait that really underlines his technical observation, his skill at painting, and then that quiet reserve yet intense presence that he gives to his sitters. And it's an interesting work as well in terms of the fact that it is a rare work. It's related to a commission for a large group portrait of the Dowager Duchess de Fitz-James and her 15 grandchildren that was never realized. Supposedly the artist found it difficult to pose that many small children and keep them still long enough to paint them. But for me, Fantin-Latour has always had a special place in my heart because of his skill and that quiet presence that he gives to his portraits. So it's wonderful for me to have this portrait in our collection.
Then the other Canadian artist involved was James Wilson Maurice of Montreal, who grew up in with a wealthy background and was trained in the law, but largely lived his life abroad in Europe, largely in France. But he was also sort of a bird of passage, and he painted in other countries like Morocco with Matisse. And his works are small but exquisite, and there was our works that were stolen were largely Venetian subjects. So there were three in the theft by Maurice. One is the corner of the Doge's Palace in Venice, and one is called Etude Venise which shows a woman with auburn hair in the foreground. And the other is another Venetian subject.
Some of the stolen works were created in very significant art communities and movements.
The Still Life by Georges Braque from 1926. And Georges Braque, again, a major European modernist of the 20th century, who, along with Pablo Picasso, invented Cubism in the early part of the 20th century. This particular work comes from later in his career, but you can certainly still see the influence of Cubism with the flat decorative shapes and the form, abstracted forms of the objects, whether the fruit or the cup on the table.
The Bremner is a building with lots of trees in the foreground and a beautiful treatment of shadow. He was a major Canadian artist, and it was painted in France, and it's called Martigues. We own numerous works by William Bremner in the collection. He's a traditional painter, I would say, in the conservative tradition.
All these works of art were high profile and big money. It's amazing that they were vulnerable to theft in any way. The thieves may have been monitoring this gallery for some time to find a weakness in its security system.
It seems the general consensus from the newspaper reports at the time would suggest that that particular gallery, it was a quick way to take some very valuable works.
They were in and out possibly within the half hour, and they did limit themselves to the precious paintings. So it's possible they had been reconnoitering. It's possible.
With such a small amount of time to execute the crime, the thieves were brutal with the art. Despite knowing the value of these masterpieces, a great deal of damage was done.
They treated everything so badly that it's hard to know what respect they had for what they were doing as well. They cut virtually 8 works out of their frames with a knife.
As an expert conservator, a critical part of Sandra Lawrence's job description is forensic analysis of damage to artworks.
What we have on the screen are 2 of the paintings that were in the group that were stolen. The one on the left is the young Fitzjames by Henri Fantin-Latour. And this is the Still Life by Georges Braque. The Fantin-Latour was actually cut out of its frame, so if the thieves had come along, here's the painting in the frame, they would have taken a knife and just sliced along what's called the sight edge. This would be, if you can just look in the corner here, what a painting would be like in the frame, ignoring the cut lines, of course. The painting would sit like this so that when the thieves came into the gallery, rather than trying to take the whole painting away in the frame, they simply cut around like this. Now, just to look at the back of this so that we can see what it looks like, you can see that the painting rests inside the frame on this little ledge, and that little ledge is called the rabbit or the rebate. They cut the painting off, rolled it up to take it away, and what was left behind was this stretcher with the residue of the painting on it.
They smashed all the frames. They were hindered by the fact that one of the very large French works was backed with plywood, and it resisted their efforts, so it was thrown to the floor and smashed, and another smaller work, but very valuable work, was snapped in 2. So all the frames were broken and the works were removed, rolled up.
The next morning, the gallery's superintendent arrived at work and discovered the devastating evidence of the theft. In Gallery 6, 10 frames lay broken and empty. Most pieces were on canvas and were cut out of their frames, presumably for ease of transport and concealment. But one painting proved too much of a challenge for the thieves. Martin Luther's Doubts by James Tissot was savagely slashed down the middle when frustrated thieves couldn't remove it from its backing. Sadly, this piece would prove too badly damaged to ever be displayed again. Upon investigation, the police soon concluded the thieves had sawed a rough hole through a bottom panel in the rear door of the gallery. The 1960s rudimentary security system had failed to activate. The thieves must have known the alarm was intended to ring only if the door was opened by force. Police combed the gallery for fingerprints and uncovered very little. Detectives suspected the thieves belonged to a nationwide art theft ring, although these suspicions were never confirmed. Months later, newspaper tip-offs hinted that the thieves had attempted to make a deal with the gallery's insurance company, but this was only more speculation.
There was an anonymous call made to the police a few days after the theft, asking if there was a reward. And one newspaper account hinted at the fact they were attempting to negotiate with the insurance adjusters.
Because at the time of the theft, the dozen works that were stolen or damaged, basically the insurance value was about $55,000.
In the case of James Wilson Maurice, and we own quite a number of Maurice works in the Hamilton collection, at that time, in the evolution of Canadian art, there were not high evaluations on a lot of Canadian artworks. Several in the theft were only valued at $15,000 each. In 1995, at a Joiner auction in Toronto, a work of his called Bullring Marseille sold for $529,000. So that gives you an idea of the escalation in Canadian art prices. He's very esteemed, and we're lucky to have as many as we do in the collection.
And when you think today, a work by Brock, a painting by Brock alone, one painting can go for over $1 million US.
But there was a lot of speculation, and because so much of the whole thing is shrouded in mystery, it's very difficult to know.